Welcome to the CWA Radio Network, brought to you by Christian Women Affiliate. You're listening to a-musing, hosted by me, Heather Randall. What if every thought is deeper than a daydream? What if it's a seedling from our Heavenly Father, our one true muse, pointing us to something we need to know? Let's embrace the freedom to wonder, take the invitation to explore, and learn everything He has to teach us in this amazing journey of life. After the show, we invite you to join us at ChristianWomenAffiliate.com. Let's get this show started.
Hello and happy Friday. I'm so excited to dive in and chat with today's guest, Kathy Carlton Willis. I will be meeting Kathy in person later this month at the Successful Writer Conference here in Oklahoma, which is hosted by the Fellowship of Christian Writers. Kathy writes and speaks with a balance of funny and faith, whimsy and wisdom. Not many funny girls also have Bible degrees. Kathy is a pastor's wife, which gives her plenty of opportunities to grin with grace. She shines the light on issues that hold women back and inspires their own light bulb moments. Almost 1,000 of Kathy's articles have been published in books, magazines, newspapers, and online publications. Kathy's tagline describes her best: light and lively, his reflection, her laughter. Kathy lives with her husband, Russ, in Rockdale, Texas. Hello, Kathy. How are you doing today?
Hi, Heather. It's great to be with you.
I'm glad you could be with us today.
Thanks.
You juggle many interests as an author and a speaker and a coach. So today I want to tackle as many of your talents and interests as we have time for. But I saw your beaming smile on Twitter yesterday, holding up a copy of Grin with Grace, your newly released Bible study. So I know that you're dying to share about that and how excited you are about its debut. So go ahead.
Well, you know, Grin with Grace is sort of my go-to phrase. I've used it often in life. It gets me out of a lot of trouble, and it helps me kind of factor in the right perspective when it seems like things are kind of stinky. You know, we all have those days when things aren't that great. And something just dawned on me that if that helps me get through the day, that all of us need a little bit of grace for our days. And so I did a word study on grace, and that's sort of how we started the Bible study, Grin with Grace.
That's great. And I think that phrase just suits you perfectly. Your smile is contagious. The pictures I've seen, I'm like, wow, your smile is great. Can you give us some examples of when that phrase has come in handy for you?
Yeah, you know, I am a pastor's wife, as you mentioned, and as much as I love ministry, and I've done ministry most of my life, but there are those days when a member has an agenda that's not exactly pleasant, and I have to remind myself to grin with grace to get through that uncomfortable moment where they need to share with me something that I need to be doing better, or something they think they need to bring to my attention, or maybe they think I need to get my husband's attention. So that's just been a good phrase for me to kind of, you know, if you start with humor, the grin part of Grin with Grace, it just kind of helps you take the seriousness out of a situation and realize it's temporary. And when you realize it's temporary, you can get to just about anything.
That's very true. Now, the Grin with Grace Bible study has a different approach to studying Scripture. Do you want to tell us about that?
Well, you know, I've been through lots of Bible studies throughout the years, and I've led quite a few of them, and I love them all. But it seems like a lot of them are really heavy in learning the facts of Scripture without learning the application. And Grin with Grace actually has four parts. It starts out with stories. Some of them are humorous, some of them are heartwarming, so we're sort of like chicken soup type stories. And then we go from there to our Bible study portion, and from then we also teach how to both go and give with grace. So it's learning how to be an instrument of God's grace to other people, because I think whenever we study any topic in Scripture, if we aren't letting it change our own lives first and then using it to encourage and minister to other lives, then we've really kind of missed the point of studying what that scripture means. And so I'm really trying to emphasize all four aspects of growth so that we can make a difference and not just become smarter Christians about what the Bible says. So that's my approach. And a lot of Bible studies also have a daily reading, and this one is just a chapter a week or two chapters a week, depending on how you want to do it. And some women are busy all week and they only have one or two reading times, and that works well for them. Or the ones that are really organized, they can divide out how many pages they want to read a day, and it works for them too.
That's great. Do you see it being more of a personal study, or would this apply to groups wanting to host Bible studies?
That's a great question. I promised the Lord that any Bible study that he led me to write, that I would always test it out with a group first, because I don't know about you, but I've been in some studies that might be good to read through as a book, but they don't work quite as well for a group interaction. And
right.
So all of the books that I write that are Bible studies have been through an actual group, and that way I know they function well in that way. But they also work well for those that can't get together with a group of women, or if they want to do it on their own. Some of them are adopting a Grace Gal Pal, so there's just a couple of friends, you know, that get together and mm-hmm. have some accountability and prayer with each other. And I've actually done one of the groups online, so women that can't really adjust their schedules or they're not able to get out, we were able to do it online, and that worked just as well, too.
That sounds really fun. So what do you understand grace to mean?
It's funny that you asked that. Today on the trip home with a couple of friends, I told them we'd be talking and that we were talking about grace today, and I asked them what they thought it meant, too. And one thing that we realized was just grace is that thing that we can't work up ourselves. It's something that only God can do. And mm-hmm. he has not only sufficient grace, which means enough, but he has abundant grace. He has that grace that's overflowing. And because of that, he can supply it for any situation we have, whether it's just an everyday situation or whether it's a trial we're going through. And I know that a lot of people think that it's just for the day that they come to faith in Christ. They think of saving grace, but he does so much more than save us with grace. He equips us and he fills us, and it comes packaged in so many ways that even if we explored it every day, and I've explored it for several years now, I still don't understand it all. You know, it's just one of those things that moves and changes with me as God knows what he needs to do to change me.
When I think about all of the topics and all of the concepts and ideas that are, you know, within Scripture, how did you come up with the idea of grace as being your focus for the study?
I think it really started when I first started hearing the word in Christian circles. It was sort of mystical to me, or mm-hmm. mysterious. It was that concept of something that I knew I really couldn't tap into on my own. And to be honest with you, the first couple of years I studied it, it seemed like the more I knew about it, the more I didn't know about it. One year I even played a character named Grace in a children's musical. I was the grown-up version character for the play, and even the children taught me things about grace that I didn't know, and the songs taught me more things. So it seems like no matter how much we explore that topic, there's more that we need, and I think that God exposes us to just what we need to be able to use it for that day. It's sort of like manna. It's just enough for that day.
Mm-hmm. I agree. I love how you're looking for grace sightings, as you call them. When you just spot grace out in the world, I think that's really cool.
Yes, that's something fun we're doing this month on social networking is grace sightings, because one thing I do a little differently when I promote a book, a lot of authors, we're trained that we're supposed to really bring a lot of exposure to the book, because that's mm-hmm. the way we can make a difference with it. That's the way we can get it in people's hands. But I just decided, I mean, we're talking about grace, and so it has to be something more than about what I'm doing, obviously. It would be kind of hypocritical to make it about me. So we're doing these grace sightings all month long of different ways that I see grace in the world, and sharing pictures and quotes from other people, and just making sure the spotlight isn't on me, but on everything that God is doing about grace.
Yeah. It's clever, and it's neat. How can believers become an instrument of God's grace to others?
That's really something that I'm passionate about because, again, going back to that Bible study concept, if we can't really continue to grow as a Christian if all we're growing in is the knowledge. Obviously, we're supposed to grow in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus, but we're also supposed to be that instrument of grace to other people. And, you know, part of it is just giving the benefit of the doubt when maybe they're having a bad day. And rather than judging them on it or being cruel or having a misunderstanding, is just giving them enough amen for that day. And other days, it's giving grace to ourselves because sometimes the hardest we're on anyone is ourselves. So we have to give ourselves a break, too.
Absolutely. And you're right. That is so hard. We can be our worst enemy sometimes.
I know.
The story of the chrysalis and the little kiddo's house in your book. Can you share that with our audience?
I would love to. I was telling the ladies in the car today about little kiddos, and they're my age, but for some reason they couldn't remember little kiddos. So I'm still on the lookout for a playhouse similar to the one that I had as a kid. It's just basically a little dollhouse, and the dolls are much smaller than Barbies and just quite fun. But the story of the chrysalis, one day while I was out, I think I was about six, I found a chrysalis, and I didn't even know that was the name. I thought it was a cocoon. You know, that's easier for six-year-olds to say.
Right.
And I brought it home, and I told Mom, you know, look at this cocoon. Look at it. What, you know, I found a cocoon, and it looked sort of like a pod. You know, it looked like a seed pod kind of thing, and I didn't really quite know what it was, and that was the moment that Mom got to explain to me about what a chrysalis was, and then she also taught me the word metamorphosis. And she told me that this wasn't the end of that caterpillar's life, but just the middle stage and what was going to happen next. And she also wanted to give me a dose of reality. So she told me that because I had handled it and we didn't know how long it had been out in the elements, that it's possible that nothing would happen to it. But because I always have been a big believer in hope, I put it in my little kiddo's playhouse for whatever reason, thinking that must be the star place in my room to give it. And so I put it in there. And every day I would kind of peek in and see what would happen to it. And, you know, some days I just thought, oh, nothing's going to happen. And other days I was filled with this huge hope that maybe something would happen. And one day when I opened it, there was this butterfly in there, and it was still drying the birth juices off of its wings, and it looked like stained glass wings. So they were translucent yet colorful and beautiful. And I just felt this love like only a six-year-old who thinks they're a parent can have. And I saw this transformation happen in my own little kiddo's playhouse. And what I thought was a cocoon really looked a lot like a coffin. You know, I thought it was a dead caterpillar's coffin, and instead it was just the birthplace for this beautiful butterfly. And I learned what transformation was, and the reason why it's in the book is because part of what grace does is it transforms us from what we used to be to what God knows we can become, and it's always something more beautiful. But in the process, the reason why we need grace is because oftentimes the things that makes us beautiful are those trials or those dead spots where we think nothing good will ever happen again, like that cocoon. And instead, God has something much bigger in mind for us. And so that's just what's the best part of that story, was seeing that butterfly. And I know Mom was relieved that I wasn't going to have, you know, this poor dejected little six-year-old that didn't get to see the rest of the story. And then I had to let it go. You know, I had the choice. It could stay in the little kiddo's playhouse. But if it did, I knew it wouldn't last very long, and only I would get to enjoy it. But by letting it go, I was able to let nature enjoy this beautiful creature. And that's sort of what it's like to be an instrument of God's grace, is using what we have to help spread that for other people too, and not just hoarding it to ourselves. So that was the lesson that I learned from the chrysalis.
That's really exciting that you had such a insightful moment, even as a six-year-old, that it's something that impacts you today, and that God has given it to you to use as an example of His grace. I think that's wonderful.
Thank you.
You know, when we think about grace, you know, we often think about salvation and how the two are connected. But how can God's grace change a person's life on a daily basis, not just when we initially come to the faith?
You know, earlier I mentioned that it's similar to manna, and it really is. Just like the Israelites had to search for manna on a daily basis, we have to search for grace on a daily basis. And if we let it just be part of our beginning of our faith, we will kind of be stunted in our growth. And the only way we will get these growing spells is by being in tune to grace and what it can do to our everyday lives. And I think it helps us have a better attitude. It helps us have more love for other people. Mm-hmm. And it fills that spot in us that humanness cannot fill. You know, grace is putting something that's God's inside of something that's man's. And that's the only way I can explain it, is that realizing this empty spot, it gets empty again every day, and we need that filling so that we can operate in the grace that He wants us to have for other people.
As you researched the word grace in God's Word, what key concepts did you notice over and over?
Well, one of the things I noticed was there were a lot of passages that combined other keywords with grace. It's like grace had these partners. It mm-hmm. doesn't really go alone in the Christian faith, but it pairs up with other words that mean a lot to us. Words like mercy, you know, you see grace and mercy together and seeing how they operate together. And then also grace and peace go together. And if you think about it, grace is the vehicle that gets us to the destination of peace. If we didn't have grace, we wouldn't have peace. Also, kind of going along with that, comfort. The word comfort is tied in with grace a lot too. And I think about how the Holy Spirit came to give us comfort. And when we have His grace, we're able to tap into that comfort. So there were quite a few words that just were tied in together. Probably my favorite, though, was hope. Grace and hope going together. And hope is believing in something even though you don't see it. And I think grace, it would be the glasses that we put on so that we can see it. And that's just the thing that we need to be able to hope even when there isn't hope, and to be able to cling to it when we don't see the outcome yet. And grace helps us bear the middle part better. So that was probably my favorite part of the study, was seeing how grace partners with other things to help us get through the Christian life.
That's really neat. Grin with Grace is available for pre-order. Listeners, you can get all of the purchase links by visiting Kathy at her website, kathycarltonwillis.com. The link is also available in my show description, so be sure to stop over there and get your copy. You'll see a whole list of places that you can purchase, and you can choose the place that you prefer to shop at best. This has been an exciting year for you, Kathy, as you have another title, Speaker to Speaker, the Essential Speaker's Companion, scheduled to release in August?
That's right, August 1st, just at the end of summer even.
Tell us a bit about that.
Well, part of my profession is equipping writers and speakers to get to the next step in whatever God has planted in their lives to do with their communications. And I've written, I don't know how many columns now, for The Christian Communicator. And I was recruited to take some of those articles and turn it into a book and kind of expand on what I did in the monthly curriculum and use that for a full book. And so it's just really exciting to see. It's like a toolkit of everything a speaker would need to be equipped for the how-tos of speaking and running it more like a business, and even thinking of new ways to speak or new ways to get your the word out that you're a speaker, getting more gigs, what to do with the troubles that happen. So it's just another neat way that I can help equip speakers and writers so that they have the tools they need to succeed. And I'm excited that it's coming out soon. It's with Next Step Books.
Okay, so we'll be looking forward to that on August 1st. Now, beyond writing, Kathy is gracious about sharing her knowledge, as she said, to encourage fellow writers through coaching and speaking. Kathy, when did you begin coaching?
Oh, that's a good question. Probably 2005 was when I first had my first coaching client. And a lot of it started with editing and giving them feedback on their manuscripts. And then as every time I learned something new, I decided I needed to be able to share that with other people. So when I learned how to do book proposals, I started helping other clients with book proposals or with speaking, or, you know, just the different things as I grew. It just felt like something I needed to be doing with my coaching, too. And I'm, boy, with all of the different clients I've had, I've also had publicity clients for literary publicity. So I've probably had about 200 clients since then, and it's just been really rewarding to see those light bulbs go on and to see how God's using what they're doing.
That's wonderful. And I am actually going to be one of the people that Kathy gets to coach. So
yes.
As I mentioned in the intro, Kathy will be speaking at the Successful Writers Conference on May 29th and 30th. She'll be teaching the biblical view of promotion and your call to spread the word through God's marketing plan, among other things. She'll also be having coaching sessions with attendees who request a session. And I was quick to sign up, and I can't wait. I'll be talking with Elise Hollis later this month to address the event itself in more detail. But listeners, you do not have to wait until then to snag your tickets, and you shouldn't. So you can hop over to the successfulwriterconference.blogtalk.com to order your tickets today. Okay, now Kathy's heart for writers doesn't even stop at writing and coaching and speaking. She's also the founder of Word Girls, for Christian women who write. What is your vision for that group?
One thing that I noticed with a lot of the organizations out there, they do a really good job, but they have to be sort of cookie cutter in their approach because they are dealing with quite a few writers and speakers at once. And that's great, but the downfall to it is it's not customizable to the people that really need it. And so I started Word Girls this year to be able to take some of that coaching knowledge and coach an entire group at one time. And so they sign up to join the group, and it's there's a membership fee to join, and they join for a year at a time. And for that, they get monthly webinars, they get to go to conferences, they get tutorials every month that they download, they get a newsletter, so many ways. And the best part, though, isn't what I provide, but it's what the support they're giving each other and the encouragement they're giving each other through a private Facebook page. And probably that's been my favorite thing to see happen because they don't even know each other, but they're there encouraging each other. So I've been really excited to see that. I'm going next week to South Carolina to our first Word Girls weekend getaway, and so we'll actually get to see some of the girls in person, and that will be a really good time too.
How fun. So give us the site again. Where do we need to go for that?
Well, they probably need to email me because it's a private site since it's by membership only. So if they will contact me, I will let them know. June is our next open enrollment for members, and we only take a limited number of members because we do offer boutique services, meaning that it's tailor-made for each member and not just template-type services offered to everyone.
Okay. So go ahead and contact Kathy if you're interested in that. Now, at the outset, I promised to cover as many of Kathy's interests as possible. I warned you, Kathy, I have a silly thing coming. When you visit Kathy's website, you can learn a ton of serious and silly details about her on her About page. Now, on that page, she admits to her unrealized dream of being a lead singer in a band. We're going to have a bit of fun. Kathy, imagine you have attained that dream. You're standing on stage. Are you panicking yet? Okay, so Kathy, I'm not going to ask you to sing. You can breathe. But what I am going to ask you is to tell us, if you were in that moment, what song would you sing?
Oh, that's a good question. Oh, I'm trying to think which one that I would pick. Somewhere Over the Rainbow is usually my glory song, so probably mm-hmm. that. But it would depend on the band, you know. If the band was contemporary, I would pick something upbeat, and if it was classical, I would pick something more traditional. So it just depends. Right now, I've been thinking about the old hymn, "He Giveth More Grace" by Annie J. Flint, because the words go so really so great with "Grin with Grace." So that's another one I've been working on, but it's not ready yet.
Do you sing at church?
I do. In fact, my husband and I met in music in high school. I was a majorette, and he was a baritone horn player. And he always says that he started to follow me around the field, and he's continued to follow me ever since.
How fun. And you're a pastor's wife, so you probably play the piano, right?
You know, that's one of the things they told me at Bible college that I would need to learn to do, and it is the one thing that I have never done. I have the smallest little hands, and they just are not built for piano playing. I used to play the clarinet, and now I'm grateful I can sing. That's my contribution to our music program.
Well, I love it. I think we just bonded over that fact. I was a pastor's wife for 10 years. I'm not. My husband is still in ministry, but he's no longer a pastor. And that was the thing that I just did not have, that all the other pastors' wives seemed to be able to do, was play the piano. Not me. Not at all.
And it's always the first question they ask you on the interview is, do you play the piano? No,
it
sorry.
Is.
I don't do that. I don't really do the nursery. But anything else, I'd be happy to do.
Just once, I'd like to see them go, okay, well, we can't hire your husband then because you can't play the piano. It's just funny questions they ask in pastoral interviews.
I know.
Is he a senior pastor?
He is. This is our third senior pastorate. He's also filled almost every position. Of course, we started with youth and music, and then he went to larger positions in music, leading choirs of like 100 and orchestras of 20 and doing all of the orchestration. So we do have a pretty heavy music background, but we love pastoring and can't imagine doing anything else.
That's great. Well, we're just about to close up, so we're in the last few minutes of today's episode, but let's close out with a scripture. What do you think?
That sounds
Kathy,
good.
Of all the grace verses in the Bible, which one would you like to leave us with today?
You know, there were quite a few scriptures. I was amazed at how many times I saw grace, but I think Acts 20:32 would be a great one to close with. It's, "Now I entrust you to God and the message of his grace that is able to build you up and give you an inheritance with all those he has set apart for himself." And I do pray that those that are listening, that they will realize that God will build them up.
That's wonderful. So please, if you're a listener, hop over to Kathy's website, pick up your copy of Grin with Grace, learn more about her and her other writings as well. Thank you for being with us today, Kathy. It was great talking with you.
Thank you for having me.
I wish you all the best in your writing, and I look forward to seeing you on the 29th. Yay!
Yes, very soon.
And if you want to be there with us, go get your tickets for the Successful Writer Conference. Listeners, I hope to see you all back next week for a fresh episode of A-musing, featuring guest Lisa Cook of For His Beloved. Be blessed. Thank you for letting me share my ideas with you for the last 30 minutes. You've been so kind. See you next week.